Good morning. Welcome to this worship service. I am so glad you have joined us for today's worship. Originally, Pastor Jim Stoneman was to lead worship. However, he was not feeling well and asked me to step in. I am Cindy Lemke, co-lay leader, lay pastor for the Wadena Church. I wish to thank Tanya and Lee for their efforts in making this service possible. And I would like to send a happy Mother's Day wishes to all those women who throughout our lives have cared for, loved us, helping us to become who we were and are meant to be. Let us pray. O God, whenever we gather together in your name, may it be with a full sense of your presence, with a deep appreciation for your guiding power. We ask that you build in us an experience and an understanding of worship as a time of stories, a time of hearing stories, for sharing stories, for enacting stories. Sharpen our ability to listen to the accounts of biblical people, to participate in their struggles, trials, and triumphs. Help us to hear in such a way that we are able to discern your call for faithfulness within the arena of human history. Encourage us to share our stories with one another, to open ourselves so the Spirit may reveal new possibilities for reconciliation and growth, intimacy and joy. Speak your stories to us throughout our worship, and may our lives reflect its power. In your name we pray. Amen. Today's first scripture reading comes from the book of Acts, chapter 7, 55 through 60. But filled with the Holy Spirit, he gazed into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. Look, he said, I see the heavens opened and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. But they covered their ears and with a loud shout all rushed together against him. Then they dragged him out of the city and began to stone him. And the witnesses laid their coats at the feet of a young man named Saul. While they were stoning Stephen, he prayed, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. Then he knelt down and cried out in a loud voice, Lord, do not hold this sin. Today's second reading comes from the 31st Psalm, verses 1 through 16. In you, O Lord, I seek refuge. Do not let me ever be put to shame. In your righteousness, deliver me. Incline your ear to me. Rescue me speedily. Be a rock of refuge for me, a strong fortress to save me. You are indeed my rock and my fortress. For your name's sake, lead me and guide me. Take me out of the net that is hidden for me, for you are my refuge. Into your hand I commit my spirit. You have redeemed me, O Lord, faithful God. You hate those who pay regard to worthless idols, but I trust in the Lord. I will exult and rejoice in your steadfast love. Because you have seen my afflictions, you have taken heed of my adversities and have not delivered me into the hand of the enemy. You have set my feet in a broad place. Be gracious to me, O Lord, for I am in distress. My eyes waste away from grief, my soul and body also. For my life is spent with sorrow and my years with sighing. My strength fails because of my misery and my bones waste away. I am the scorn of all my adversaries, a horror to my neighbors, an object of dread to my acquaintances. Those who see me in the street flee from me. I have passed out of the mind like one who is dead. I have become like a broken vessel. For I hear the whispering of many, terror all around, as they scheme together against me, as they plot to take my life. But I trust in you, O Lord. I say, you are my God. My times are in your hand. Deliver me from the hand of my enemies and persecutors. Let your face shine upon your servant. Save me in your steadfast love. And here ends today's readings.
Thank you.
As we come to our time of joys and concerns, I would like to lift up Roland and Jim, who are in need of our prayers for continued and improving health. Let us be in a time of prayer. Tender and compassionate God, you ask us to pray for all people. At this time, we offer these prayers to you. Gracious God, we pray for the faithful. May your people be one in spirit and love throughout the earth. We pray for those who rule. We pray for those who govern every land. Look with grace upon the leadership of this country. Turn the hearts of leaders and peoples to you, that governments may seek the good of humanity. Let us pray for the homeless and the hungry. God, you suffer with those who suffer. We pray that those who are without shelter or food, may we listen without judgment to their stories and act with compassion in helping to provide for their needs. Let us pray for the sick and grieving. Holy Comforter, grant your peace and healing to those who are sick and those who grieve. We especially lift to you those members of our church family, Roland and Jim. Radiate through their lives so that health and strength may be theirs. Let us pray for our family and friends. On this Mother's Day weekend, we especially lift with gratitude all those who have acted in loving ways towards us, moms and stepmoms, foster moms and adoptive moms, aunts and neighbors, grandmothers and godmothers. We especially hold in our tender love those who wish to be moms, but for whom motherhood was not to be. And lastly, we pray for ourselves. Help us to see the joy and abundant life you intend for us. Help us to feel your guiding presence in all that we do. And now please join with me as we pray the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who have sinned against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. On most work week mornings, I can be found in our living room working on homework. As a paraprofessional in the high school, I have two primary responsibilities during this time of distance learning. Each morning, I check online to see what the physical science, health, and algebra teachers have assigned. I determine how best I can support the students. I contact by email the classroom teacher, that my special ed classroom teacher, and then I begin my work. I might put page numbers down for worksheet answers. I may take screenshots of web pages with notations to help them download what they need. During the afternoons of every other week, I work at the child care site for the students of parents who are Tier 1 healthcare and emergency response employees. During the rest of my day, I have had time to get some projects done around our house. The current project has been prepping and painting our back entry and dining area. It is amazing to me how long it takes to do this, to prep an area to be painted, but I am progressing and I have some new paint on some of the walls. To help with my motivation for this project, I have been listening to music. While I spackle, sand, wash walls, put up painter's tape, and eventually paint. To my delight, I have discovered Spotify, a phone app that asks questions about the kinds of music you like and groups, etc., that you enjoy, and then puts together playlists based on those choices. My music preferences over the years have been heavily influenced by what my older brother would listen to when he was still at home. And through him, I discovered the music of Harry Chapin. For those who may not know who Harry Chapin was, two of his songs that were played on the radio were Taxi and Cats in the Cradle. Now, most of Harry's songs told a story. Cats in the Cradle was the song about a father who was often gone on business trips, who, although he loved his son, could never quite seem to find time to spend with him when he was home. The son was understanding, would tell the father it was okay, and that someday he hoped to grow up like his dad. And by the end of the song, when the father, now retired and older with an adult son, when he called to see if he could visit his grown son, the reply he received was that the son's new job was a hassle and the kids had the flu. But it's sure nice talking to you, Dad. It's been sure nice talking to you. And at that point, we realize that the boy, now man, had grown up to be pretty much like his father. It was a story, or it is a story, about common people living their lives the best they know how, yet oftentimes falling short of where they wished they could be. Today's reading from the 7th chapter of Acts begins at the end of a person's story. Today's reading is just a few short verses which describes the stoning and death of Stephen, the first of many Christian martyrs. Stephen's death signaled the beginning of the severe persecution of Greek-speaking Jews living in Israel. This persecution made it necessary for these Hellenistic Jews to scatter out of Israel and into the surrounding Gentile lands. Now, Stephen is first introduced in the 6th chapter of Acts, when he, along with other male Greek-speaking Jews, were chosen by their community and then appointed by the apostles to see to the needs of the widows of the Greek-speaking Christian followers, essentially making sure that these women were well-fed and cared for. The criteria that the apostles gave the community of believers for being chosen for this ministry was to be a man of good standing, full of the Spirit and good wisdom. As one of the chosen, Stephen was described as being full of grace and power, who did great wonders and signs among the people. Among those who witnessed Stephen's signs and wonders, who were men who were Hellenistic, Greek-speaking Jews, but were not followers of Christ. In the Jewish tradition, it is common for the religious to discuss theological issues. Each person or group would argue their point using examples from their faith history to support their argument. The non-Christian Jews would argue with Stephen, but could not withstand the wisdom and the spirit with which he spoke. Frustrated by their inability, the men stirred up the others and told lies, alleging that Stephen had blasphemed against Moses and God. Stephen was arrested and brought before the Sanhedrin, a council of judicial authority within the Jewish system. Instead of defending himself against the false charges, when asked if these charges were true, Stephen began speaking, and in his speech, he accused the hearers of not upholding the laws of Moses. His speech was much like the speeches of earlier prophets. His words were similar to those words that Jesus spoke, trying to point out the errors of people's ways as they became more focused on rites and rituals than they were on the people who needed their care. His main theme addressed God's constant care for the people of Israel and the consistent failure of the people to live out their role as God's people from the time of Moses to the present time when he spoke. This enraged the people. I am sure Stephen, like Jesus, knew what was about to happen. As he stood just prior to the crowd dragging him away, Stephen turned his face upward and saw the glory of God. The last words Stephen spoke were similar to Jesus' final words. They were a plea for forgiveness for those who were about to kill him. Stephen's life had ended. However, the story he told within the speech he gave, the story of God's people, continued on. We, my dear people, are living in strange times. Scary times that, while quite real in terms of illness and death, suffering, separation, and economic uncertainty, do not always feel real. Our routines and schedules have been disrupted as we physically distance by mostly staying home, going out only when necessary or to work, and trying to stay at least 6 feet apart when we do go out in public. Many stores and businesses remain closed or can only provide curbside service. Among those places we are told not to go is this place. This building, our church, where we have met every Sunday to learn and grow in our faith, to connect and reconnect with God and each other. A place where we come to celebrate the good times and to support one another when life is difficult. A place of gathering which renews and strengthens our faith so we can face the days to come. Yet, I assure you that while disrupted, the story continues. God has always provided and still provides and will always provide for a plan B. When Stephen was arrested and brought before the Sanhedrin Council, he was charged with blasphemy against God and Moses, as well as the temple, the holiest places, a place built to house God. The Sanhedrin was told by those accusing Stephen, "This man never stops saying things against this holy place, and the law, for we have heard him say that this Jesus of Nazareth will destroy this place and will change the customs that Moses handed on to us." In Stephen's response to these accusations, he does address the building of the temple in chapter 7, verses 44 through 48. Our ancestors had the tent of testimony in the wilderness as God directed when he spoke to Moses. Our ancestors brought it in with Joshua and stayed with them until the time of David. This was the tent where the priests would go in to be near God. They kept it with them until the time of David, who asked that he might find a dwelling place for the house of Jacob. But it was Solomon who built a house for him. Solomon who built the first temple. And this is what Stephen said. He said, "Yet the Most High does not dwell in houses made with human hands." Stephen's speech continued for more verses as he handed down a severe indictment against the Jews for their lack of faithful living. And then Stephen was stoned. But instead of ending the story with Stephen, they in fact caused the story to spread. Because with Stephen's death was the beginning of the severe persecution, and God provided the plan B. The Greek-speaking Jews who were followers of Christ scattered for their survival, and they scattered into the surrounding Gentile lands. And instead of the story ending, the story spread into the lands into which they moved. That story continued, and it continues today. I really wish we could be together for worship. I want to be in this space with all of you. For now, however, we wait. We wait until our options are weighed, a plan is made, and the authorization is given. In our waiting, it is important to remember that the Most High does not dwell in houses made with human hands. That's not to say that God isn't present here, but God isn't present just here. God is present wherever Christians are, wherever God's children are. The status of the church doors, whether they are opened or closed and locked, does not stop us from living out our faith. The church goes beyond these walls and windows and doors. The church is not meant to be contained. We, as the body of Christ, are called to take Christ's teachings with us wherever we go. We are to live out our faith in all that we do and with all that we are. We wait, and in our waiting, Masks are sewn. Phone calls are made to those who we are concerned with. Letters and cards are sent. Errands are run. Worship is shared online. Donations are given and prayers are raised. And through it all, God's story continues for God's people. A story of faith and love and hope that continues from now and into whatever our future may bring. Amen. I send you today with the blessing, with the priestly blessing spoken by Aaron at the time that the Hebrew people were beginning their Exodus journey. May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and go in peace. May God bless you in the days ahead. Amen.